Howdy, it's Tanya. Now, there's not a lot I like more than picking a car, picking a nice track, and just hot lapping for an hour or two, Suzuka being my absolute favourite real-life one to do with. However, when you have dozens of games from arcade races to sims, each with dozens more tracks, the choice can become overwhelming. It seems, however, like closed-circuit games with fictional tracks are becoming rarer and rarer. Gran Turismo 7 seems to be the last bastion, at least until the new Forza Motorsport releases. Every racer can license in a track like Spa or the Nordschleife, so it doesn't really feel like a big deal anymore. What really makes a game like the upcoming Rennsport one that I really would want to play over? Assetto Corsa, Competizione, rfactor 2, or even GTR 2? I'm not really an online player, so the only draw for me would be minute differences in the physics or immersion, and I'm not really willing to shell out money or hard drive space for another copy of the same GT3 cars and circuits I already can't drive on. Arcade races too seem to have slowed down on this front. There aren't that many, but most are going open world, saturating that market with what seems like yet another Forza Horizon. Test Drive Unlimited Solar Crown and the Crew Motorfest aren't looking super appealing just yet. And games like Grid are leaning further into arcade spins on real-life tracks too. But fictional circuits, or open worlds, used to be part of the unique identity of a racer, part of the draw. I used to pore over the covers of pre-owned games on the PS2 shelves to see if they were worth picking up, based on the track list. Circuit design is a finicky art, like game or level design is, and it's not easy to get right. So here are 10 of my personal picks of fictional racetracks. Only one track from each video game franchise will be picked, meaning, who knows, maybe a part 2 will be in order later. Winky face. There are still plenty of games I haven't played. Anything exclusively on any Xbox console, anything for the PS4 or 5, the closed track Need for Speeds before Underground. And if there's a track you absolutely love, why not say so in the comments, nicely. Please. And why not subscribe while you're at it? This list is not in any particular order, but number 1, I would say, is the best. Alright, number 10, Spa-Francorchamps. Wait, what do you mean Belgium's real? I guess I'll have to change. Okay, then instead, number 10, Prague Short Reverse from Forza Motorsport 7. Imagine, if you will, a street circuit, except it's good, it's challenging. Even though it's really short, every single corner presents a massive challenge to the driver. Debuting in Forza 5, while I'm playing it in Forza 7, it was intended to show off the Xbox One's graphics in one of the prettiest cities in the world, with roads only really based on the vibe of the city rather than actual real-life roads, which is why it's still eligible for this list, and a track like Città d'Aria from Gran Turismo 4 isn't. At least in Forza 7, the fictional circuits, while pretty, aren't particularly memorable in terms of layout except for maybe sometimes a single corner section. Filled with constant radius, medium to high speed corners, driving these circuits in a slow car just isn't that fun. But this circuit's an exception. The forward circuit's good, but that last corner, being a tight 90 which widens and increases in radius into a 180 degree, which is fairly unassuming normally, in reverse is the manifestation of all the evil in the world. If someone wrote a guide on how to unsettle your car, brake while cornering from high speed on a bumpy city road is the number one option. Plus, the exit of the corner is very narrow with no runoff areas, just a barrier you'll hit. That you will hit. But the track doesn't let up there. Just a few seconds later is a near full speed chicane which requires threading the needle over huge curves with the propensity to turn your car into a bike or get you flagged for track limits. Almost immediately into another chicane, even looser and full speeder still. These two chicanes are fast and incredibly difficult to thread the needle through, but you get the reward of crossing the bridge. But don't look too much at the vista because you're braking again into a double apex right that has a deceptively wide exit. It actually narrows from the outside as it goes into a tunnel, and then it's a deceptive, again, chicane, which looks like one you could take out speed, but don't trust your instincts, this one's actually slow. And then it's the final straight. That corner there doesn't exist. What a ride it was, very, very short, but highly enjoyable, and one that leaves you on the edge of your seat and your car on the edge of its tires. Number 9, Tobin Raceway, rfactor. The original rfactor was an iconic game. It created a modding community likely almost as large as the one Assetto Corsa has today, but not quite so many remember the original tracks the game came packaged with, and I think that's a shame. Tobin Raceway is one of my favourites. Bumpy, not particularly wide, and with huge elevation changes, it has everything you want for a challenging hot lap experience. The first sector's fast, with corners that dare you to just go faster than you should, and then it immediately dives deeply downhill for three consecutive medium speed corners. The braking zone is downhill, making it tricky to judge distance. After the second corner, you start to climb again, meaning you're taking concave corners. So you have less grip, and I always lose the rear just a little bit here. Then the track goes from fast to technical rapidly with a hairpin. Approaching the end of the track are two very tricky corners, a medium speed downhill which you immediately have to dive to the right up for a tight but fast 90 left. Taking this at speed is exhilarating, but you don't have time to let it sink in because there's a difficult right left chicane which you have to take your chances with cutting, as the sweeping turn just after requires you to be on the left of the circuit. Overall, this track is great fun in any type of car, and if you don't want to dust off your original copy of rfactor, there exist mods for other games adding it. Number 8, Loch Rannoch from Toca 2. If you entered Bigly as your player name in Toca 2 for the PlayStation 1, you unlocked a bunch of extra bonus tracks. Or you could, like, play the game, but as a small little babby, if there were cheats available, I would use them. It's where NeoSeeker was one of the first websites I ever used. Just like the last few tracks, a big feature of this one is its bumpiness. But since this is an old PS1 game, your car going over the bumps looks a little janky. Another main feature of the track is the split path. Twice you get the option of going left or right. For the first split, the left is mostly straight but with a tough corner just before they cross. And the right path has the worst jump the physics system can deal with, and I hate it, and it makes me cry out in anguish as it reminds me of the Sisyphean struggle that is life. No matter what I do, I get the same result, the boulder crushing my bones and will to live all in one, but I have to continue to push the boulder. Maybe if I lift? Maybe if I slow down? What if I take the jump at an angle? It doesn't matter. Nothing matters. The track splits again over a bridge where you can choose to take a narrow off-road route where you have very little grip, or you can take the tarmac route, which has a tricky chicane series which you really have to abuse the Super Tourer's surprisingly bad brakes to get around. Finally, you cross the jam, which really puts the cherry on the cake for what is a classic track. It was actually redone in the game Toca Race Driver 2 later, and while that isn't the track we're focusing on today, it is pretty good too. Number 7, Hirochi Raceway from beamng Drive. Number 7, Hirochi Raceway from beamng Drive. Ah, beamng, the upstart sim driver cross-vehicle crash-em-up that's been taking on the big leagues for physics. It is unmatched in terms of pure driving feel, at least when driving road cars without downforce. And if you want to feel that on purpose-built circuit, Hirochi Raceway is the one for you. I can never decide which layout to use when testing, so I tend to alternate between all three. But this time, we're using the full-on long circuit. You start off with a long sweeping left without any room to resettle your car before the greatest high-speed chicane in the game. It's right, left, right, while wrestling with the car at high speed before you get to breathe again. Then it's up, a large hill, and down again with a set of corners that will test your throttle control before a few more sweepers. The track is, just like my fave Suzuka, a figure eight with a bridge. But don't spend too long looking at the ants beneath you on the other side of the track, safe in the knowledge you're halfway to lapping the peons, or alternatively, that they're halfway to lapping you, because it's immediately onto the brakes for a very tricky slow right kink into a left, which you can use all of the track, and more. A brief trip through the gravel during the S's that you thought were faster than they actually are leads you to a relaxing 180 back to the starting line. While you'll never really be able to test out the top end speed of your machine, you will certainly know the limits of your tyres and suspension. Number 6. ASIC Nove ballisticng. ballisticng is an incredible, underrated game that deserves to shine in its own right. Out of the shadow that the often used label Wipeout clone places it in. I mean, yeah, originally it was a Wipeout fan game as AGR2280, but it has done so much over and above that label with plenty of incredible tracks I could talk about. However, the one I will talk about, it's also one that shares a name and has a similar layout to the first track that was ever fully finished for this game. And that's right, it's the one that's hard to pronounce, ASIC Nove. As the campaign progresses, the tracks get harder and tighter, and this is one of the earlier tracks in the base game. So it features a few very distinct sections that would teach you how to deal with them for the harder tracks and the higher speed classes. You have the first sector, where the track will break to an angle multiple times. There's also a bit of a threading the needle moment where you have to be particularly careful. Upon reaching the indoor section, you'll be greeted with a long 360-degree turn before being spat out into a more technical final sector. If you've donked the wall too many times, the pit is long, but the exit is a struggle. While it may be a sulphurous browny yellow, this track is an excellent one to test any craft and hone your skills. Plus, I absolutely recommend picking up ballisticng if you haven't already. For just over a tenner, it's well worth the asking price, and there is a modding scene too. Number 5. Western Canyon Long Penny Racers. A lot of these tracks I'd describe as a roller coaster, but that term can apply perhaps the most out of all of these to Western Canyon Long from Penny Racers, or also known as Gadget Racers or Choro Q HG1, depending on where you live. The track map is resoundingly unhelpful because of just how much the track goes around. It's a few corners and then some corners again. Even a rally co-driver couldn't keep up, I imagine. You just have to go with the flow. Oh, it's up a ramp. Then it's a 490-100 left into a triple right. Where am I going? The elevation change is constant. There are ramps. There's a shortcut over a pit if you have a glider. There's both road and dirt, so good luck picking tires. There's no runoff for most of it. In fact, at one point it's possible to fall off the track and have to be airlifted back on. Plus, I mean, it's literally on a winding set of train tracks. How much more roller coastery can you get than that? Halfway through there is a fork in the path where you can take a much shorter route, which is very difficult to reach, or a longer route, which you will end up inevitably straying onto. Finally, there's the music, which is unique in that this is one of the only tracks to have a separate music track for the short and long courses, which means even the game thinks this track is something special. It's a banger, perfectly conveying that this is the final track in the game. It's heroic but climactic, and it's been playing in the background, but here is a proper listen. Number 4. White Mountain Burnout Revenge. Pretty much every track in Burnout Revenge is amazing. Chock full of more traffic than pretty much any other game, shortcuts that drastically change the whole layout of the course, and huge ramps means you won't spend much time relaxing. But White Mountain is something else entirely. It is incredibly challenging to make it round without crashing, the hardest aspect being the serrated or crenellated edge that every wall seems to have. No wall riding for you. Most of the time is spent on a rural road, twisting with hairpin turns, dirt road offshoots, and rock formations, shaped suspiciously like jump ramps. Then you make your way into a town which has so much shortcutness it pretty much counts as having two separate routes. The shortcut cuts through a historical building and jumps onto the roof of another, letting you completely ruin the peaceful life I'm sure most of the people that moved there wanted. Then you climb back up through the more hairpins, and to the hardest part of the track. It's a fork in the road. It looks unassuming, as it's just a slight corner, but on one path is a jagged wall, and on the other path is a narrow bridge, neither of which will let you touch the wall at all. It's a surprisingly difficult end to what is a fun ride. 3, Silverstream, from Wipeout. Ah, yes. If I were to include ballisticng, what kind of person would I be if I didn't then include Silverstream from the original Wipeout? By far the hardest track in a game that's not particularly easy anyway, mostly due to not being able to use the analog sticks, you will struggle on this one. You will struggle on this one. Heck, trying to get a clean run for the recorded footage was not possible for me. The track has forks in the road three times. If you don't take the left path for the first and third time, you will lose. The right path is just so much slower, even if it is slightly easier. In a game like Wipeout that has fast, literally floating machines, the idea of having to pretty much turn a hairpin on a narrow track with very little room for error seems ridiculous. And it kind of is. And yet, there are four. Four hairpins. You don't have to properly slow down using both air brakes at all for the whole game up to this point, yet here it will be very difficult if you don't. And if that's not enough, the circuit has speed pads that launch you straight into the wall, and thus are ones you should avoid. This blue bonk will grab you by the neck, kidnap your kids, and stuff them into an animatronic suit to forever haunt a pizzeria in the late 20th century that has a low hygiene rating, and I love it. Number 2, Overpass City / Union Hill District, from Rage Racer and Ridge Racers 2. Now, I haven't played the original Rage Racer, but I have played the PSP game Ridge Racers 2, which includes every track from the first few Ridge / Rage / Rave Racer games, and the track that was in Rage Racer called Overpass City, which in 2 is called Union Hill District, is incredible. Forget what I said about elevation change for the last few tracks. This one goes up at least a kilometer like the chain lift of a roller coaster. And once again, I'm going to use that analogy. But I mean, come on! You take the first chart part, which is in every Raid Racer track, split off to the chain lift, and it's up, 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 building excitement, and then it's a white knuckle ride down and round and up and down again, and then it's all over the place, and I'm drifting backwards around a corner, and whoop, is it over? Nope, just as a final screw you, there's a little chicane just to mess you over. Only then can you relax once more. With the spline-based drifting that Ridge Racers has, it's pure fun from A to Z. And then you get to do it two more times! Such fun! Number 1, Grand Valley Speedway, from Gran Turismo. And I'm sure the question you've all been asking is, which track from Gran Turismo is going to be chosen? And it's a tricky choice. Unlike Forza, the Gran Turismo fictional tracks are more consistently well designed and of high quality in terms of layout and scenery. And just as I'm writing this, Grand Valley comes back to GT7, not that I own that game. But it's the best one from the originals. I can understand Polyphony's willingness to change Trial Mountain and Deep Forest for GT7 since their layouts were, while great for driving, not quite as great for their newer esports racing focus, since there aren't quite as many overtaking opportunities. But Grand Valley Speedway already had a great balance between having something fun to drive on and something great for racing, so they didn't change it much. A long straight into a curve braking zone for a hairpin, which is surprisingly tricky, leads to some great S's and then another hairpin. Then it's some medium speed corners into the first tunnel, before some long sweepers. You cross a beautiful bridge and enter another long sweeper in a tunnel. Then it's a slow left-right chicane before you get back onto the back straight. Though don't underestimate the last corner or you will meet the gravel. It feels like one of those fun country roads you can just have a good time pushing the car to the limit on. You have to be patient with the throttle, or you will be chewed up and spat out onto the grass and sand. But you get breathing, unlike some of the other tracks on this list, where you can just let the beautiful vista sink in. It's just a good time to be had by all. So that's 10 of the greatest fictional tracks I know. When making this list, there were way more than 10 extra, so another video is possible. I mentioned it before, but circuit design is like level design in any other game. It's got to be unique and well designed. What makes a racing game unique? The car list? Many have the same cars under license as each other. The track list? Many have the same tracks under license as each other. The physics? Many have gone for a realistic set of physics. Fictional circuits are just one part of a unique identity for a racing game. I love fictional circuits, and really hope they stick around. What are your favourites that I haven't mentioned? I'm sure you have many. Please say so in the comments, and don't forget to like and subscribe. Signing off, Tanya.